On behalf of the Visiting Research Professors Program of Goa University, I welcome all of you to this extraordinary session on an extraordinary subject, what is Nalanda tradition and what is its value today, by an extraordinary speaker, Pen Kampo Tashi Tsering. I invite one and all, and I invite one of the most extraordinary vice chancellors we have, to officially welcome you all. Sir?
Thank you very much, Professor Kirkar, and a very good morning to everyone. Tashi Dalek and Namaste. It's wonderful to have you all join us, and we anticipate that the numbers will increase in a few minutes from now, participants. I would like to begin by giving on behalf of the entire university a very warm welcome to the Venerable Kampo Tashi Tsering, Abbot of the Serame Monastic University and the first holder of the Dalai Lama Chair in Nalanda Studies as part of the Visiting Research Professor Program of Goa University. We are so honored to have you with us, Geshe Tashila, and we really are looking forward to hearing you this morning. A formal introduction of our distinguished speaker will follow my opening remarks of welcome. We are really in the presence of one of the great minds of our country this morning. Also, a very warm welcome to Sri Rajiv Mehrotra, who is the Managing Trustee of the Foundation for Universal Responsibility of His Holiness the Dalai Lama. This is something that sort of we are so happy about. I will be talking a bit about our relationship with the Foundation for Universal Responsibility in just a moment. And also a warm welcome to Dr. Anita Dudani, who has been a great sort of help to Goa University in setting up the initial moves with regards to setting up of the Dalai Lama Chair. On the 10th of December last year, Goa University signed a memorandum of understanding with the Foundation for Universal Responsibility of His Holiness the Dalai Lama. It was in fact a very important day. That was actually also the 30th anniversary of the day on which the Nobel Peace Prize had been conferred upon on His Holiness the Dalai Lama. The next day on the 11th of December, we were deeply honored and privileged to have the Dalai Lama spend time with us at Kala Academy and deliver his lecture, which I think was widely appreciated, the learnings that we all received that morning. So we have, of course, a formal relationship of cooperation and friendship with the Foundation for Universal Responsibility. This relationship with the Foundation for Universal Responsibility of His Holiness the Dalai Lama is intended to support us in establishing programs of advanced study in the Nalanda tradition. And specifically, what we have agreed to do is establish the Dalai Lama Chair for Nalanda Studies at our university under our Visiting Research Professor Program. And the Dalai Lama Chair will focus on the study of wisdom, that is sutra, and also method of practice, which are aspects of an ancient tradition under the umbrella of a modern Indian university. And apart from didactic studies of the Nalanda texts, our initial phase of cooperation will also encompass mediation, meditation and training of the mind, logic and debate, Buddhist metaphysics, conflict resolution and peace studies, and gender studies. We are looking forward to hosting many distinguished scholars who would, by their knowledge and skills, enhance our understanding in these important knowledge domains. And the first of these great scholars who is occupying the chair is Geshe Tashila, Venerable Kampo Tashi Tsering. So that is the context in which we are meeting this morning. The intention had been that through the year 2020, we would have a number of events, face-to-face visits by distinguished scholars who hold the chair to reflect on all of the areas that the Dalai Lama chair covers. But as you know, we have spent this year in the shadow of this global pandemic. But at Goa University, we felt that it would be really unfortunate if the first year of the chair passed without any activity at all. And so, I took the liberty of contacting Sri Rajiv Mehrotra and suggesting that we could perhaps, have at least some events in the virtual mode, and through these online events, at least begin our activities on the chair. So this really does mean a whole lot to us. And after his lecture to us, Geshe Tashila will have a short conversation with Sri Rajiv Mehrotra on some of the themes that he is covering, after which Dr. Anita Dudane will coordinate the question and answer session. So we will request the participants in today's meeting, today's event, to kindly, if you have any questions, to please type them into the text box, and they will be, some of them will certainly be placed before our distinguished speaker. Why is the Nalanda tradition so important to us today? Well, let's look at it this way. For seven glorious centuries from the fifth century of the Common Era, the Mahavihar at Nalanda was not only a repository of ancient wisdom, but also the site of a unique method of teaching learning that we desperately need in India today. And the Nalanda method was about cooperative, argumentative dialogue between the teacher and the learner, based on asking and answering questions in order to stimulate critical thinking and to draw out ideas, underlying presuppositions, and inherent contradictions. And if the Indian education system is to ever emerge as a fount of creativity and innovation, we must emulate, incorporate, and repatriate the Nalanda tradition in our institutions of learning. Now, all of the great masters of the Nalanda tradition, all 17 of them were Indian. Nagarjun, Aryadev, Buddha Palit, Bhava Vivek, Chandrakirti, Shanti Deva, Shanti Rakshit, Kamalashil, Asanga, Vasub Bandhu, and so on. So this was very much an Indian tradition. But when Nalanda fell in the 12th century, an entire tradition of scholarship, in effect, disappeared from India. And it would have been lost forever had it not been transplanted north of the Himalayas in the great Buddhist monasteries of Tibet. And so it's really kind of, it's really history working in large cycles. 9 centuries later, we believe in Goa University that the time is ripe for the Nalanda tradition to once again be transplanted, this time from Tibetan monasteries to Indian universities. And of course, we will keep this soil fertile, so that the sapling of the ancient Bodhi tree takes strong roots in our university system. I hope this has helped to contextualize our meeting today. While we are thinking about a very important topic, this is also inaugurating a chair which is associated with a glorious name, a glorious office, a glorious person, and it's a chair that we think will really contribute to revitalizing our university and the teaching learning process in our university. So once again, welcome to everyone. And I, like everybody else in this meeting, am looking forward very eagerly for the learnings that we will receive from Geshe Tashila. Thank you very much. I will turn this over to Professor Savita Kirkar now.
Thank you, sir, for your warm welcome. We at Goa University believe that universities are centers of free thought. Universities are places where knowledge should flow freely, and universities are places of pursuit of knowledge. We also believe that universities are the centers for rational thought, thinking which believes in reasoning and rational deductions. It's no wonder that we have invited Ben Kampo Tashi Tsering to enlighten us on the Buddhist thought processes, which we believe are the most rational among the world religions. Buddha was an atheist. He did not believe in God. His thought process was almost like scientists in physics, chemistry, or biology laboratories, which believe in experimentation and data deduction. Geshe moved to India from Tibet to escape the occupation of his country by the Chinese. And he had years of education in Buddhist thought and has been closely associated with His Holiness, the Dalai Lama. He has taught in many universities in the world since 1991. And today he will talk about the Nalanda tradition. Nalanda, which is in Bihar, is the oldest university that the world has ever seen, where students from far off countries throng to seek admission. Hearing about this subject from a man who has been appointed by His Holiness, the 14th Dalai Lama, as the 91st abbot of Sera Mae Monastery University, will be a treat to all of us. Let us all welcome Geshe-la to share his thoughts on one of the greatest and the oldest universities that the world has ever created, Nalanda. Yes, sir, I pass the mic to Geshe-la. Welcome. Namaste. Namaste.
Namaste. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. So, it is really a great honor and a privilege to participate in this gathering, and also to be the part of this very great potential project, work together with the Goa University and the Foundation for Universal Responsibility of His Holiness Dalai Lama's Trust. And I'm really grateful to the Vice Chancellor, Professor Varun Shani, Professor Shavita Karka, and Shri from the Dalai Lama's Foundation Trust, one of the trustees, Shri Rajiv, and also coordinator Aninda, and all the people who make this project, and to turn into a very, very useful and helpful for the long term, to benefit to the many, many living beings, not only in this country, but also all over the world. As Vice Chancellor briefly touched on, the importance of reviving some of those great, great Indian knowledge, traditions, back to this country, and then gradually to spread to the world, which, many of the great thinkers, including His Holiness the Dalai Lama, sees it is extremely important to have this kind of initiatives. And Goa University last year very kindly accepted this project with the Foundation for Universal Responsibilities of His Holiness the Dalai Lama. And when I was asked to part of this project, I felt great honor and also felt great humble being part of this project. And today, although Goa University and one of the our monastery in Monbut, Jebung Nosling Monastery, have some exchanges going at the Goa University students coming to the Tsering monasteries, participating, and some good culture exchanges. So now we would like to take this project more, you know, the structured and for the long term, you know, the well-established, very, what you call the helpful and useful project, not only from this university and eventually to, you know, get to many other learning institutions in India, as well as gradually to spread to the world. And this is one of the main His Holiness Dalai Lama's commitments, you know, to revive the great Indian knowledge back to the 21st century. And His Holiness says it is perfectly possible if we work together, you know, there. And it is not just possible, there are great potentials to make it happen. So therefore, you know, I'm very grateful and humbled to be part of this project. So now the why this project is so important, before I touch on today's our main topic, I would like to say a little bit on why this project is so important at this 21st century. Although the, you know, these learning traditions were existed more than, you know, the 2000 years in this country and all other parts of the world, why it is so crucial in this 21st century. Also, that is a part of one of our main topics today that I'm going to talk. Now, this country, India, in Tibetan, we call Pakpe Yul, Gyaga Pakpe Yul. That means the land of the realized beings. Land of the realized beings. You know, for many hundred years ago, the Tibetan thinkers and, you know, great practitioners have seen, you know, the India and the Indians are very, very, what's called source, very important source of, you know, the important culture, not just in Buddhism, but also many other ancient Indian spiritual traditions. And, you know, that's why the, you know, the name, land of the realized being. Realized being in the sense, you know, the Indian people are very, very, you know, cultured to practice ahimsa, non-violence, and also extremely, you know, the nurtured by the, you know, the teachings of many great realized beings, including the Lord Buddha. And through that, those teachings, Indian people are nurtured by love, compassion, altruism, and so forth. Therefore, the title, you know, the Indian India is called Land of the Realized Being. So now, these two important subjects, ahimsa and karuna, which are really some of the key factors us human beings and also non-human living creatures on this planet to live peacefully, to live in other, what you call the mutual respect, and to have tremendous sense of love, compassion, and altruism to each other. And living that kind of life, individually and collectively, within the family and within the society, is, you know, the one's own, you know, the benefits, and it is also benefits to the others and, you know, the, to the humanity. When we talk about ahimsa, we are not talking about simply absence of non-violence. And that is something very important part of this tradition, not only in the Nalanda Buddhist traditions, but also ancient Indian traditions, spiritual traditions, have a how to practice ahimsa, not just absence of violence, but very much looking inward, our inner world, working with our inner world individually, then, you know, the, what you call the conveying or spreading the non-violence to the outer world, to the outside world. And this, you know, the Nalanda tradition, and, you know, the, is something very, very important part of that cultivation of that kind of knowledge, our inner, what you call the sources to bring ahimsa, to practice ahimsa. Then in the second part, cultivation of love, compassion, although as a human beings, you know, we all have a naturally deep sense of, you know, the sense of goodness, such as love and compassion, these mental attitudes can be expanded, can be cultivated further than naturally that we have. And that kind of cultivation, that kind of further, very deliberately further development of love, compassion, and altruism is also extremely relevant to, in general, ancient Indian traditions. And here today's topic is in the Nalanda traditions. So on those two subjects, the topic that we are going to touch on today, and hopefully in the coming months, years, you know, through this initiative, that is the main reason why reviving some of these great ancient Indian, you know, the traditions are important. And that's what very often His Holiness the Dalai Lama expressed that. So I will not go that much detail to the next point. Now we are going to touch on our main topic, what is the Nalanda tradition. First, you know, as one of the earlier, you know, the speaker briefly talked about where is Nalanda and so on and so forth, and also, you know, the Vice Chancellor briefly touched on, you know, the many great Indian masters, you know, were come from that institution. That institution, Nalanda, you know, the Buddhist study institution or learning institution, it is a part of, you know, the many learning institutions during, you know, the earlier part of the, you know, Common Era. Not only Nalanda tradition, Nalanda monastery, you know, the learning center, but also there are other learning centers around the Nalanda, like Vikramashila, and also some other learning centers. And these learning centers, you know, are the really important centers to produce, such as mentioned earlier, such as these great thinkers like Nagarjuna, Ayadev, and so forth. Many, many great Indian masters, thinkers were produced from these institutions. And some of these great Indian masters came to Tibet, such as the Kamalashila, Shangurakshita, Kamalashila, Atisha, came to Tibet and taught the Tibetan teachers this tradition. So that is the really the connection, how, you know, the Tibetans have got this amazing treasure, you know, that started around late 7th century, and, you know, continue up to the present time. As Vice Chancellor briefly mentioned, you know, that there are already in India, there are many, you know, great monastic institutions to study. Many of these great Indian thinkers' treatises and their commentaries. And many of these treatises are translated into Tibetan language in a very early time, from Sanskrit into Tibetan. So therefore, you know, in the Tibetan, current Tibetan monastic institutions hold some of these great treasures. And these great treasures now, His Holiness Dalai Lama says, it is the time, and for many different reasons, it is the time to hand over to the Indian, particularly those younger generations. And, you know, so therefore, you know, the through these, you know, like Goa University, we would like to, you know, hand over, or what we have, some of these great treasure came from India to Tibet, and whole, you know, more than 1,000 years now, you know, would like to hand over to the Indian, those younger generations through the different institutions, and to bring new Nalanda, the learning institutions. I think 2000, I can't remember exactly, already there is a central government have an initiative to build, to cultivate, to develop a Nalanda University. So that is something which we would like to look at to move forward. And as like the the ancient Nalanda Nalanda learning institutions, these institutions, you know, the slowly that we develop to become a international learning institutions, to come from all over the world to study these important topics. So what is Nalanda traditions? During those, you know, although the, you know, the current, the ruin that what we see in Nalanda, in Bihar, it seems, you know, historically, those buildings were started around 5th century, Common Era. But that area where the current ruin Nalanda, you know, ruined buildings, that area seems for long, long term a learning, you know, a place before the, you know, the current structure were built. For example, when the historical Buddha, he spent many times in that area, you know, with the help of Magadha, you know, king and so forth. And one of his close disciples, Shariputra, came from that area. So, and also after Buddha passed away, soon after Buddha passed away, first Buddhist council to gather all his teachings, you know, the, those great realized beings come together, and they did the first council, council in that area, in Rajgir. So it seems, you know, that area was very, very important learning area, you know, not even before Nalanda Monastery, Nalanda, the learning institution was established. So what is Nalanda tradition? Now, in terms of the subject matter, what these great masters have had studied in there, you know, many of the common science or common knowledge, such as Vedas, logic, Sanskrit grammar, medicines, are also the subject or the topics to study. Not only, you know, the Buddhist subject, although it seems the Buddhist, you know, the topics are the main subject to be studied in that institution, but that institution, in that institution, there were many other subjects to be studied. And in that sense, we can call that ancient Nalanda institution as one of the earliest universities in the world, because there are many different subjects and many different subjects were studied. And also along that, they have studied non-Buddhist topics such as Samyak theories and other non-Buddhist spiritual traditions, philosophy. Then within the Buddhist, the teachings or the Buddhist teachings, you know, those earlier 18 schools, or sometimes called 18 sects, 18 schools of Buddhist, you know, thoughts, were also studied. Then on top of that, one of the main topics what they have studied are the, you know, the Chittamatran schools philosophy, thoughts, you know, the mind, sometimes here translated mind-only schools, thoughts. And then also, you know, the Madhyamika schools, thoughts, you know, the philosophy. Then Buddhist logic, Buddhist epistemology, Buddhist psychology, Buddhist ethics, you know, many of these topics were taught and learned and practiced and put into their daily lives from that, you know, those masters from that institutions. And that is what Nalanda tradition is. Nalanda tradition, in terms of the topic or the subject, these are the main topics or the subjects. And these are studied in a very, very rigorous, critical manner, not just purely accepted by the, what, who, by, taught by the teachers, including those Buddhist thinkers, including the Buddha's, his own words, were critically examined, critically analyzed, investigated, not purely accepted because Buddha taught. And that is the really one of the important, what you call the tradition, important, you know, the methodology to exist in Nalanda tradition. and which, you know, in here like this, and the monastery where I am, Tsering Monastery, we still, you know, use these critical analysis to really to learn and study these important topics, subjects. And currently, you know, our main means or the mode of study is through debating. You know, the initially to understand our, you know, the opponent's point of view or the thesis. Then really to argue. After you understand your opponent's thesis or the, you know, the thesis, then you can argue, put forward your own argument to challenge, you know, the assertions. And that kind of critical studying is something very, very important, what you call the tradition which exists in Nalanda, and you know, the what you call the still in the Tibetan Buddhist monasteries where they have study program, we still do that. Now, going back to the, you know, the Nalanda, you know, the institutions, you know, their traditions. Like, for example, I just want to give you one or two examples. The first example is this. When the, you know, the these Buddhist logics, Buddhist epistemologies, when these are established, mainly around 5th or 6th century by Dignak, Acharya Dignak, and followed by, you know, the Acharya Dhammakirti, the development of Buddhist logic and epistemology is very much through the interaction with the non-Buddhist, you know, the schools, thinkers, that schools, you know, their philosophies. It is not just purely, you know, the Buddhist sort of concept, or it is through the interaction with the, you know, the such as the samchas, such as the, you know, the what you call the other, you know, the Nyanika and Vairasheik and Sanchez, those great thinkers, you know, through the interaction. And I think that is something what I am bringing over here. Why I'm bringing over here this, you know, example is current, you know, the modern science, cultured development of modern science, understanding of human, you know, the what you call the, you know, the human brain capability and nature and the structure, and also, you know, the modern way of studying through the critical analysis with the outside, you know, external world. And that way of studying, which already exists now in 21st century, many of these big universities, you know, your students, do that through the critical analysis. Then, you know, you write your thesis, you write your dissertations, and then, you know, through the different, you know, what's called fields of science, like physics, and like, you know, the neurologies, and so on and so forth. these two traditions, ancient Indian traditions, which has tremendously rich to explain our inner world, our thoughts, our emotions, and our, you know, the what you call the, you know, the our capability to, you know, to cultivate inner value through the analysis, through the investigation, and, you know, through critical analysis. That approach, that kind of approach, and that kind of knowledge, try to bring to the, you know, the modern what you call the way of studying, bringing these two close to together and supporting each other, you know, supporting each other, one can help other. As we all know, you know, as we all know, the modern education is, as His Holiness Dalai Lama says very much, says modern education is very much material orientated education, not very much to, you know, education to develop inner values. And what we need here is in a combination of these two, you know, that of course we need material wealth, which is important, but it is also important for us to have the inner world, our inner treasure is love, compassion, and altruism, tolerance. And these are the subject matter which critically explained by these great Indian masters, explain how to cultivate love, compassion, altruism, tolerance. You know, there is a one I want to share you another brief example. That is this. Another one of the great Nalanda master, I think around the 7th century, Shantideva, who composed amazingly important texts, how to cultivate within ourselves, how to cultivate, you know, love, compassion, altruism, tolerance, and so forth. And he, you know, explain how to cultivate this through, you know, detailed, logically explained, not just, you know, dogmatically, but logically explained that is possible, it is perfectly possible to cultivate, to enhance love, compassion, altruism, tolerance, and so forth. In that one of his texts called, you know, The Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life, you know, Bodhisattva Avatara, he examined, you know, when he talked about cultivation of tolerance, when somebody, you know, cause a harm or cause a pain to your body, we feel he or she caused harm to my body. We have this strong sense of my, you know, relation to our body. And he said, you know, is it really true this body is yours? And there is recently BBC has a one nice program which is called BBC Earth. And in that program, there's one sort of what you call the segment. And in that, it is called How Much of Your Body is Your Own? That is very, very nice, you know, the explanation to going through the every part of our body, all the building blocks of our body, then examining and then asking this question, you know, how much of your body is your own? And, you know, so therefore, you know, there is a very, what you call the common sort of, you know, ancient Indian, like these great Nalanda masters, understanding of the outside world as well as the inside world, and also some of the modern, you know, scientists, their understanding of the outside world, and to bring these two together to benefit to our, you know, to the humanity. And another important topic which I want to briefly touch on is this, which is not unique in Nalanda tradition. It is very important, you know, the ancient Indian tradition, which is the cultivation of, you know, the shamatha, concentration, or calm abiding, and the cultivation of vipassana, or, you know, the insight, which is very common, you know, the methodology used by ancient Indian spiritual traditions, not just, you know, the Buddhist masters. And these two sort of methods to cultivate calm abiding or shamatha, which is the mind which have a, you know, quality of stillness and a quality of clarity, shamatha in that sense, and also vipassana, inside the mind, which our mind, which has a extremely capable to analyze, to investigate some of the most detailed, you know, the reality of the world, of the things and events. And these great Nalanda masters, such as Nagarjuna and so on and so forth, they use these two techniques, shamatha and vipassana, to enhance love, compassion, altruism, and other important knowledge, to understand the realities as they are. And that is something which, again, another relation to our second topic, which is the why, you know, the what is relevant? What is relevant this tradition at this 21st century? You know, what is the value today's, you know, this Nalanda tradition? It is extremely useful and helpful at this 21st century, this great tradition, this kind of tradition, because we are very much, our entire sort of focus is very much outside world, material development, and just, you know, how we look at, you know, the external appearances. We have a very little time and, you know, the energy to put how to make ourselves rich and wealthy, our internal world. And this, you know, I will give you one simple example. When I was in London doing my MA in social anthropology, I write my paper to see whether the mindfulness meditation movement can be called as a social movement. You know, the mindfulness meditation is exploded in the world. You know, wherever you go, talk about mindfulness meditation. Can we count that, you know, my thesis was, you know, can we count that as a social movement? For that, I did, what you call my research talking to two or three international banking CEO, you know, to ask them who are doing mindfulness meditation, ask them how much benefit do you get doing the mindfulness meditation 10, 12 minutes every day. All these three bankers, top bankers, they all said it is extremely useful and helpful for their life, for their job. So now the mindfulness meditation, what they do is very, very simple without any, meaningful content in that mind, those mindfulness meditation. Simply just focus to your breathing or just to be right here and now. Very, very little content in that meditation, but still they feel it has doing mindfulness meditation benefited a great deal in their daily life. And that is the evidence. And that, these kind of, other Indian culture, like yoga. But what happening nowadays, these amazing ancient Indian culture, important cultures, take it out, the important contents of those, like a yoga, like meditation, but simply put forward in a very, very simple form, then it called the mindfulness meditation. Why I'm saying that is, it is very, very clear we need to revive some of these in ancient Indian the traditions to the modern world, to the 21st century, because our emphasis is very much just to the material development, and that makes particularly younger generation really cause huge trouble. I know, because I lived in London for many years, I know many young Westerners, from the modern education, they have all those things. The material, relatively they have all those things, but have a difficulty to really adjust their world, their life to the real world and struggle. So therefore, the current, Nalanda tradition will be extremely relevant, helpful, and important to the modern world. So I will conclude here as my introductory talk on the subject of Nalanda tradition. Thank you.
So thank you very much for your enlightening talk. And now I pass the stage to Mr. Malhotra. So I think we could start the conversation. Would you like to take over, sir?
Yes, thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you, Geshe-la, for this very illuminating and comprehensive talk that you have given us. It's planted many seeds for the talks that will follow. And I think that there are so many learnings from what you said, but in the context of the modern university and the way we are struggling with it in India and in much of the world, I mean, you truly emphasized the truly universal character of a university, free from religious, political, national barriers or ideologies that throw open their doors for all persons, irrespective of caste, color, creed, or country. I think that has been the great learning. It is also what enables His Holiness the Dalai Lama to actually go to the places of worship of different traditions and pray and learn from them proactively. I was really interested in One of the major aspirations of the program at Goa University that might distinguish it from what is happening at most other academic institutions is to be able to combine some of the elements of practice. So while you can understand intellectually or read and then be exposed to great scholarship about aspects of the Nalanda tradition, unless you've had a glimpse of it, and where the method and the wisdom, as you pointed to, needed to be combined, and then you so beautifully described it as where the content of a meditative practice, as in mindfulness, is missing, and so the understanding and the transformation can never be complete, and meditation becomes almost a form of anesthetic. And so it was really this idea of accelerated learning, the Tantrayana tradition, that also so powerfully manifest in the Nalanda tradition. So how do you see that playing out in the modern university?
Yes. So in the modern university, although I have a very little knowledge, the university systems and so forth, but the general speaking, the universities are very open in the sense to, as you said, without any discrimination, without any that kind of selection in terms of the race, culture, and so on and so forth. In that sense, I feel it is very important to have that kind of culture and system. But I know some of the great the Western the scholars and also great practitioners who are modern universities lecturers, modern universities professors, who also practice some of these, what you mentioned, the Buddhist Vajrayana traditions. Vajrayana tradition, Buddhist, I'm talking about in Buddhist Vajrayana traditions, the main subject matter, regardless of the different, many, various, sophisticated images, visualizations, recitations, and so on and so forth. But all these, ritual performance, visualization, recitation, all these are very much based on, again, going back to our main topic, based on, the wisdom, which is understanding of shunyata, understanding of ultimate reality, and, the cultivation of altruism, altruistic awakened mind, bodhicitta. In time, these two are the main ingredients in the Vajrayana practice, in which form that you do. Of course, concentration is one of the ingredients, but in terms of the actual materials, that these two, wisdom, realizing emptiness, shunyata, understanding shunyata, and bodhicitta, are the two main ingredients that entire your Vajrayana, Buddhist Vajrayana practice is performed. Without these two, in Tibetan we have an expression. I will just tell you that expression, because one of the Tibetan cake is called tu. It is made of main ingredient is dry, fine cheese. And it is made with the cheese, dry, fine cheese, with the butter and the sugar. And it says, if you take it away, the butter and sugar, mm-hmm. your cake is just a lump of peas. Mm-hmm. lump of cheese. And it is how it is explained. If you take it away, your experience of understanding of emptiness and your experience of altruistic awakened mind, if these two are absent, your Vajrayana visualization, recitation, and all this elaboration, meditation, such as pure elaboration, not the real cake. And that is what here.
I think there are a lot of people waiting to ask you questions, and time is running out. But I did really want to flag and celebrate what you pointed to about the about debating, and the fact that debating is not just between monks. So here you are in the Nalanda tradition. You have the great masters like Nagarjuna and Chandrakriti and Aryadeva, and these large numbers of Indian pundits. And when they were writing the text, they knew that their audience was multicultural and multidisciplinary, and that it had to stand up to the intellectual rigor and scrutiny of such a diverse audience. And so it wasn't just coming from a particular Buddhist perspective. And in that sense, that helped the sort of the expansion of the Buddhist principles, so that today we see in the world that Buddhism is very widely assimilated and accepted. So in the sense that in India, while Hinduism assimilates, I think the great achievement of Buddhism has been its ability to assimilate in different cultural contexts, because it can be filtered through the intellectual worldview of different traditions. And I think that what you've been pointing to so eloquently is that we see this so marvelously embodied in His Holiness the Dalai Lama. His willingness to be challenged, to engage in conversation, and most of all, to say, "I don't know." And that is always such a powerful moment when we all secretly sort of believe he knows, but maybe more intuitively. And I just want to leave this final thought, because as we go ahead into the lectures, is that the struggle, and this is what the Nalanda tradition was pointing to, is that the experiences that we are talking about, the aspiration of understanding, ultimately shunyata is understood non-conceptually. The limits of vocabulary in the mind. And so the genius of that tradition was to be able to give you a glimpse or an experience of what shunyata is. And, we can keep struggling with the vocabulary of emptiness, of inherent existence. Well, it's not really it. It's you, as someone who has experienced it, knows. I haven't got there yet. Thank you, Geshe-la. We're running out of time, and there are questioners waiting. And we look to flagging these many wonderful issues you have raised in the lectures to follow. So I will hand this over to our coordinator, Dr. Anita Dudane, to flag some of the questions that have been put up by the audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you.
Yes, Dr. Anita?
Yeah, I'm just...
Yes.
Thank you, Geshe-la, for this wonderful talk. Let me start with asking the question from Dr. Khandu. He has asked, would teaching and practicing mindfulness together with the right view within an ethical framework, is it a good way, but does it carry a tag of religion, which will make people go away from this, as opposed to if you don't add the tag of religion, then people might take it completely in the wrong way, as you said, mindfulness is currently happening. So how would you reconcile that, religion versus secular in mindfulness? Yes.
I think when I said the mindfulness and yoga, they extracted religious element of they take it away. That doesn't mean I don't mean if you want to practice profound mindfulness meditation, there should be a religious element. That's a, I don't mean that. You know, the His Holiness Dalai Lama says entire the Nalanda teachings in the three parts. Really, you know, there is a philosophical part. There is a science, in other words, understanding of the reality of the world. There is a depth, like a understanding of the mind, consciousness, and so on and so forth. And there is a religious part. So taking leave with the religious part, it is perfectly possible somebody can practice, you know, the profound shamatha practice and vipassana practice without taking Buddhist, you know, as a religious element of the Buddhism or the Buddhist teaching or the other ancient Indian spiritual tradition. For example, you know, to practice the mindfulness meditation with the you know, the profound understanding of, you know, the in nature of the world, nature of impermanence, which is again a very, very important reality of the world, including our own life. You know, this understanding which Buddha taught and the subsequently Buddhist teachers have argued a lot, this nature of impermanence. You know, that understanding can be collaborated with your mindfulness meditation, which is, you know, without any religious element. And also, you know, it is perfectly possible your mindfulness meditation can be collaborated with the cultivation of love, strong sense of love and the compassion with the without any religious element. And these are really perfectly doable, you know, without any religious element.
So the next question, which takes off from that, is from Professor Rahul Tripathi of Political Science. He says, could some of these techniques be used in the classroom as case studies to address contemporary problems of violence, peace, and reconciliation?
I think so. This is what I started my talk. You know, when we talk, the main reason why His Holiness really want to revive this tradition back to the, you know, the initially Indian community and to the world, is to really, he says, cultivation of ahimsa. That is what here, you know, sometimes people use the term disarmament of inner world. You know, really disarm your inner, those hatred, anger, jealousy, envy, attachment. These need to be reduced and, you know, need to be dealt with. And through the cultivation of these, you know, the practices, which, you know, used by these great Indian masters. And I think in that sense, you know, here, as the questioner asked, I think it is doable to do as a case, you know, study. However, you know, sometimes to do the empirical analysis, empirical, you know, the investigation, and to understand by the third person is not that easy, unless if we use some of those modern technology to understand your brain and so on and so forth. But I think it is perfectly doable.
Thank you, Geshe. The next question is from Professor Dayanand. He says, Gyan, the journey within, and Vignan, which is the journey without, there are two distinct aspects of inquiry. He says, most educational institutions focus on the second, the Vignan, the you know, journey without. Did the Nalanda tradition amalgamate these two journeys?
Sorry, I didn't get it that well. Journey with and without, what does that mean?
Yes, so within is, like you said, empirical analysis within yourself, and Vignan is science and outside, you know, material, okay. Science, material. So did the Nalanda tradition amalgamate, did they put them together?
Oh, yes. I think here, you know, in the Nalanda master's tradition, they talk a lot about the outside world. They talk a lot about the outside world, including they talk about, you know, the building blocks of the material things. You know, they have, even though they don't have the modern, those modern technologies, like, you know, the microscope and so on and so forth, but they talk a lot about how the external worlds are cultivated, developed, and, you know, and also they talk a lot about how to interact between the external world and by, you know, and our inner world. And in that sense, I think here, you know, the modern, what you call the, you know, the understanding about our as our tools to understand outside world is only those sense consciousnesses. But the Nalanda Buddhist Nalanda masters, they talk about more than five sense consciousnesses as a tool that we have, human beings. We have the sixth mental consciousness, which has more power than the five sense consciousnesses to understand the outside world. And also these Nalanda masters talk about how accurate our these sense consciousnesses are to understand outside world. Are there any gap between the how we see the things and events and how they are? And Nalanda Buddhist masters really have lots of explanations and diverse explanations. No, not just, you know, the one just, you know, but diverse explanations, the accuracy of our sense consciousnesses to understand outside world. So yes, there is a lots of explanation about inside world as well as outside world in the Nalanda tradition. I hope I had the answer to the question, but I'm myself not very sure.
Excellent answer. Which the next question has come from Delhi. They're saying, can in this situation of the university, can there be learning between modern science and the Nalanda tradition? Can we see this happening here?
I really hope that will happen, and that I really believe it is perfectly possible. It's perfectly possible. You know, that we may need to adjust a few things. You know, that we need to deliver the things slightly different ways. But otherwise, I think it is perfectly possible. But also, some of you know, His Holiness Dalai Lama strongly encourages us in these institutions, monastic institutions, the monks who are studying these ancient Indian traditions, also we should study the modern science. And now, you know, in our curriculum, we have included studying modern science. And there are the classes carrying on to study physics and, you know, the biologies and so on and so forth.
And the final question I need to ask you in this is that would Vipassana and actual meditation, which is very powerful to grow, would that be included in the practice in the university when it's taught as a didactic subject?
I think it, you know, may need, you know, like what you call the, you know, the small group, very dedicated people really want, and initially that kind of small group as a to create the model, then gradually to learn from there, then to, I think it's perfectly possible to, for example, when I started this course called Foundation of Buddhist Thought, entire course is very much structured as a mode of, you know, study is very much like a Western, you know, the modern study, but also included meditation as a part of their homework. And I think that is perfectly possible to bring the shamatha and Vipassana meditation as a part of the, you know, the university study, subject.
Geshe, I did say it was the last question, but it's a wonderful one more question that has come.
Okay.
And yeah. I think it will be very wonderful. It says, why do you think we have lost the tolerance to debate and have nuanced conversation? We see that everyone has their own narrative, which is what is the sole truth, and tend not to empathize with others. There's so many opposition in narratives, and they cause such great misunderstandings among us, whether it is in relation to religion, race, sexuality, caste. So what do you think, and why have we lost this tolerance? This is a wonderful question, and I would like to end with this.
Yes. You know, then, and my answer is this. Nalanda masters have suggested, as a student, you must be, unbiased. To be a student, you have to have those three qualities: unbiased, willing to learn, and I can't remember what. So unbiased is very, very important one. Very, very important one. So very often, as His Holiness Dalai Lama says, while we are in a very young age, we don't discriminate, we don't differentiate different colors, different culture, different race, and different religions. When we've grown up slowly, then we pick up all those things, culture, those things impose upon us, or we learn through the environment. But what we can do, from the very young age, we can cultivate deep and teach or bring a sort of culture of unbiased attitude. In the debating yard, occasionally there are quite strong, what you call the energy. When you debate, when you start to lose your assertions, and when your opponent's debater is very good, you may start to lose your temper a little bit. But it is important deep down to have this deep sense of unbiased.
Thank you, Geshe-la. Now I will end the question answer session and pass it on to Dr. Savita to say thank you.
Thank you very much for this very entertaining session and very cheerful session with smiles from both sides. It was very enjoyable. I'm very thankful to Geshe-la for giving us an insight to the Nalanda tradition of education, and I'm sure we have a lot to learn from it. I must thank Geshe-la for agreeing to deliver this talk, and our Vice Chancellor for being completely open to our endeavor of pursuit of knowledge and being a pillar of encouragement in all our activities. The session would have not been possible without the support of Mr. Rajiv Mehrotra, who is a kind of a rock in support of adventures of knowledge. Dr. Anita Dudhane, a charming and cheerful allergy specialist practicing in Goa, but I must point out that the pursuit of spiritual thought and knowledge is something she never allows anyone to be allergic to, nor is she. She's been closely associated with His Holiness and has always been the bridge between His Holiness and Goa and all his activities. I thank you all for being a part of this first virtual talk of VRPP and hope all of you are enlightened and reconsolidate your commitment to rational thinking. Thank you once again, and see you for the next talks. We'll be announcing them shortly, and all our other activities too. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And organizers and all the people. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you, Anita.
Ma'am, will this be available later on the YouTube or somewhere?